Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and wordly magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Set us free, Heavenly Father, from every bond of prejudice and fear, that honoring the steadfast courage of your servant Absalom Jones, we may show forth in our lives the reconciling love and true freedom of the children of God, which you have given us in your Son, Jesus, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, "See, I am sending my messengers to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who shall endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord as in the days of old and as in former years. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter to the Corinthians. If our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
said, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. Good morning. I would like to begin with a confession. I had a different scripture in my lectionary for the Isaiah passage for Absalom Jones's feast day. So I'm going to read that to you before we begin. Isaiah 42, verses 5 through 9. Thus says God, the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people upon it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prison those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory I give to no other, nor my praise to idols. I see the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you them. The word of the Lord. A plague claimed the lives of thousands of Philadelphians in 1793. Thousands reported chills, fever, jaundice, black vomit. The doctors called it yellow fever. Now, at the time, Philadelphia was the nation's capital. And while George Washington and Thomas Jefferson and Alexander Hamilton fled the city, the Free African Society, founded by two lay black preachers, one Absalom Jones and Richard Allen, stepped up to lead. They provided services that stabilized the city and, by extension, the new nation. In this unparalleled time of crisis, cleaning the streets, nursing the sick, burying the dead, and providing financial assistance to those in need. Until the following winter killed off the mosquitoes who were responsible for the epidemic. And though the white elites thanked the black community for their service by accusing them of price gouging and theft, history bears witness to the fact that the collective action of an oppressed people led by two formerly enslaved clergy, saved the most important city in the country. And in doing so, they bent the arc of the nation's history towards survival, even if that nation remained ungrateful. It is that legacy that we honor this morning on the feast day of Absalom Jones, the first ordained black bishop of the Episcopal Church. And I want to thank you for having me in this illustrious community on this auspicious day to honor his revered legacy. What I admire most about Absalom Jones is his audacity to be a cause within history rather than just an effect of history. And that is the subject I want to speak to you about today. The passage that I read to you, that I ripped from Google a moment ago, was written to the people of Israel while exiled from Canaan. And it would have been easy for them to feel like an effect of history, because the people of Israel will be passed through the hands of several oppressive imperial powers, from Assyria to Babylon to Persia to Rome. And I think it's difficult for us to feel in our bodies the texture of life living under occupation, how oppression can truncate life, make it smaller, mundane, predictable, and not in a good way, not like living by a lake or in the hills of Tennessee, but a simple life, a confined life, a life without a past from which to draw hope or a future to inspire transformative action. How it truncates the imagination of both the oppressed and the oppressor. For the oppressed, it becomes difficult to imagine being well and being free. And for the oppressor, cannot imagine living as equals with the oppressed or any other arrangement. Both are tempted to believe that the situation of oppression is permanent and that change is impossible. Isaiah speaks into that situation of exile about a political miracle, about change. Something new that God will do in collaboration with a person or community addressed in the text. And that text evokes a sense of agency. The main idea today is that we are more than an effect of history. We are a cause. So here's what our journey will look like today. We're going to go a little bit deeper into that Isaiah text to talk about how God invites them to be more than an effect of history, but a cause. And then talk about the role of human agency in history using the ministry of Absalom Jones as an example. And then we'll consider what that means for us today. But first, let us pray. And now, God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So God invites the people in the text to be a cause. It comes from a section of Isaiah where Yahweh calls on someone or some people to fulfill the role of a divine servant. Now, the reason I speak with a bit of ambiguity is because scholars are not unanimous in who God is talking to through the prophet Isaiah in this text. But there is a Jewish tradition that sees this text as being addressed to a community, so that's the angle that we're going to take this morning. I have called you, Yahweh says, to this community, to two unimaginable prerogatives for oppressed people. The first is to be well. God says, I have called you to open the eyes of the blind, so to heal. The second is to be free. God says, I have called you to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, so to liberate. And in this passage, it closes with Yahweh speaking of new things coming to fruition, a new chapter of history opening, a chapter where there will be wellness and liberation. I need to digress a bit to emphasize how subversive it is for a prophet to speak about something new happening. Because in an oppressive system, it is important for oppressors to keep the people in an endless present where there is no past to draw from, as I said, and there is no future to look forward to, as we are experiencing today with people trying to erase certain histories from our story in America. They do not want for us to be able to pull wisdom from the past and to imagine a different future based on what we know about the past. What God says through the prophet Isaiah to this community is unimaginable enough considering that the might of the imperial powers that they are under, that occupied life is essentially structured against the flourishing of the occupied, and that the occupied do not have the resources to take on their oppressors and win their liberation.
But God says this new chapter is going to happen. And it will not be directly through divine intervention, but through an expression of God-given agency, through collective action on the part of the oppressed. It will not be by begging the Assyrians to accept them, begging for a seat at the table, establishing diversity, equity, and inclusion services in Assyria, or through anti-racist book lists. Instead, God will use the oppressed to heal and to liberate, which echoes an idea implied throughout the Hebrew Bible, that to be made in the image of God means to have agency. You'll remember in Genesis 1, 26 through 27, one of the first things that God says to the human beings is to rule and subdue the earth, to manage it. And the psalmist echoes this in Psalm 115 and 16 when he says that the highest heavens belong to the Lord, but God has given the earth to human beings to rule. So if we understand this idea that to be human is to have agency, then we understand that we are not just passive characters in the unfolding drama of history. We are not extras meandering around in the background with no speaking roles. We are not NPCs for the real players on Wall Street or tech billionaires to push around. We're not even just actors. We are writers. So history is not a story that is happening to us. It's one that we are writing together. Throughout history, it has been true that a few ordinary, organized, outraged people can find a sense of agency and work political miracles together through collective action. From the first recorded instance in 1170 in Egypt, where a few workers who were building Ramesses III's burial chamber decided that they were not going to lay another brick until they were given food rations, to the current uprising to stop the genocide in Palestine and the violent occupation, history shows that when we get a sense of being a cause in history, not just an effect of history, we can accomplish the unimaginable. There was a time where the end of chattel slavery, an integrated America, a woman with a bank account, a minimum wage, were all unimaginable things, just to name a few. But these all came to pass because a few ordinary, organized, outraged people imagined a new chapter of history unfolding. And when the established political channels did not work for them, they did not sit back and say, woe is me. They did not depend on divine intervention by God's self, though they worked together. They imagined a history unfolding, one unlike the present. A future where they could be free and they could be well. Despite the fact that the structure of an oppressive society is designed against the flourishing of the occupied, and that they did not have the resources to take on the powers that be and their militaries, they took on the responsibility to do the necessary healing and liberation work to make that future a reality. They said, empire will not write our story. Chattel slavery will not write our story. Jim Crow will not write our story. Patriarchy will not write our story. Dictatorship will not write our story. They decided that they will be writers. And deep down, we know that we have this power because of the questions that we ask when we talk about the atrocities of history. We ask ourselves and one another, where were all of the good people in Berlin when Hitler was shoving Jews into the gas chambers? We ask ourselves, where were all the good white people during Jim Crow while thousands were being lynched? And future generations will ask the same question about our age. They will say, where were all the good people when Gaza was razed to the ground? Why did they not intervene? How could they allow this to happen? And the fact that we ask this question demonstrates that we know our power. We know that even our inaction is a part of the story. We know that Edmund Burke was right when he said the only thing that evil needs to prevail is for good people to do nothing. We know that neutrality empowers the oppressor. So then, how is it possible that we so often repeat these famous words about the power of our inaction to create history, and at the same time doubt the power of our collective action to do the very same thing? If it's possible that our inaction could allow a Holocaust or a genocide, then it logically follows that our collective action could prevent one. Our collective action could end the tyranny of the global militant profit-making system that dominates our present and threatens our future. Our collective action could snatch society away from the brink of collapse. Our collective action can create a future where we can be well and we can be free. And if you think I'm dreaming too big up here, then you don't understand how unfathomable the life and work of Absalom Jones was. This man imagined that black people could be well under conditions designed for our destruction, and that we could be free from a system white people were unwilling to relinquish. Read the texts of the enslavers and the slave traders and see how they did not just say, we won't give up this system, we won't give up the trade. They said, we cannot give up the trade because our society is fueled by the sweat and suffering of African captives. But Absalom Jones imagined both of those things, to be well and to be free for himself and his people. Born under the totalitarianism of American slavery on a Delaware plantation, Absalom Jones taught himself to read. At the age of 16, he was brought to Philadelphia by his captor to work as a clerk and handyman in a retail store. Well, Absalom Jones was able to work for himself in the evenings and to save his earnings. And that is what he did until he was able to purchase his wife's freedom. After Pennsylvania abolished slavery in 1780, Jones became one of the first black licensed ministers of St. George's Methodist Church in Philadelphia, alongside Richard Allen, who would later found the African Methodist Episcopal Church. Jones and Allen co-founded the Free African Society that saved Philadelphia and the nation. And though St. George's was an interracial congregation, they had not exorcised that demon of racism from their congregation, telling the black parishioners that they were not allowed to pray on the main floor aside the white parishioners. Instead, they would be relegated to the balcony or to the sides, to the walls, where they would worship God in a segregated fashion. But Absalom Jones and Richard Allen and the other black parishioners decided that segregation was not going to write the story of their faith or their future. And so they walked out of St. George's. 2 years later, Jones founded the African Episcopal Church of St. Thomas, the first black Episcopal church in Philadelphia. And in a founding document of the church, the leaders wrote that they wanted to, quote, arise out of the dust and shake ourselves and throw off that servile fear that the habit of oppression had and bondage trained us up in. In other words, they would be free and they would be well on their own terms. After becoming the first black ordained priest, Jones led petitions against the slave trade. And though the institution of American slavery would outlive him, he would live to see the end of the trade from Africa to the Americas, knowing that he and his faith community contributed to that victory. In Jones's story, you see the healing and liberating work that God calls that community to in the text in Isaiah we heard earlier. You see an oppressed community exercising a sense of agency to work political miracles through collective action. We would be remiss to use Jones's example as a story of an individual bootstrapping themselves to success, as though he did this work alone. He played his role in a mass of other black people seeking freedom. Imagine how different this day would be if no one walked out of St. George's with Absalom Jones, or if it were just Absalom Jones and Richard Allen. When I think of what they did, I see the start of a tradition that continues through the civil rights movement, where the black colleges and black churches pooled their resources and through mutual aid created a power base for them to resist the white supremacist system that was persecuting them. And their example is a testament to the power of political imagination and collective action. They remind us that when we're denied a seat at the master's table, we can build our own. When leaders refuse to provide for our flourishing, we can organize the flourishing of our communities through mutual aid. That the gospel has something to do with relieving the suffering of the oppressed, and that the church is an appropriate instrument for that relief. It's an example of how a new chapter can be written for an oppressed people in an impossible situation when we lay hold of our God-given agency. And in the seemingly unchangeable, oppressive circumstances of our time, it's important to remember that you too are a cause in history and not just an effect of history. The poet Alice Walker once said, "The most common way that people give up their power is thinking they don't have any." I believe that one of the greatest ailments plaguing our society today is a pervasive sense of powerlessness, weathering away at our bodies and souls, robbing us of the vitality that we need to thrive. That is science, not poetry. It is a scientific fact that the chronic stress of living in an unjust society causes your body cells to age faster. It can cause chronic disease. It can cause people to die early. And without a sense of agency, we don't intervene against these assaults on our bodies. So a sense of agency, no matter how small, is important to get. Whether it's going for a walk, paying that bill, having that hard conversation, it could be as big as starting a business or learning a new skill when work is hard to find. It could be leaving that unhealthy relationship. Whatever it is, getting a sense of agency on the personal level is important to get. And that pervasive sense of powerlessness also discourages us on a societal and communal level. It discourages us from doing the healing and liberating work that could save our communities. We assume that resistance is pointless. Without a sense of agency, we don't intervene against these assaults in our communities. So it's important to get a sense of agency in that sense as well. Starting a mutual aid program when the system refuses to care for us. Running for office, if that's your thing. Planning a protest, founding a new organization. In times like these, it's important to remember that we do have power. We need to get in touch with that power, to find a sense of agency, to thrive amidst adversity, and write a new chapter in history that others thought impossible. To be made in the image of God is to have agency, to be an active agent in the drama of history, and not just a passive passenger. Therefore, history is not a story that is just happening to us, it's one that we're writing together, which means you are not just an effect of history. You are a cause. So then, what you gonna do with all that power? What will this church do with all of the power that it has? How can this community mobilize what it has to do the work of healing and liberation? And now allow me to pray for us. May God give you the eyes to see that you are more powerful than the powers that be have ever wanted you to know. May you be filled with courage and hope to do the healing and liberating work God has called you to do. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in Lord Jesus, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our sins, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became a cart for the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, according to the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. One holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people. They may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace through your will all that we do.
That our works might find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress. That light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us now pray, especially our love for our own needs and those of others.
For Margaret, for Anna, for Meredith. For those on the street. Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people and the multitude of your mercies. Look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
Welcome. Welcome to St. John's Cathedral. It's lovely to see all of you. And please help me to extend just our deep gratitude and welcome to Andre Henry again for his wonderful sermon. And his call to all of us. And I'd like to just recognize, because we don't always have his presence with us, but Canon Earl Munger this morning is with us. And you may know Canon Munger often joins us from online, but he also makes so much happen from where he lives. And he has been instrumental working with a committee of many of you for Black History Month. And so it was that committee and under the leadership of Canon Munger who invited Andre Henry to be with us and also selected the beautiful music in partnership with Dr. Gravis for this month of Black History. And so I'd just like to thank you, Canon Munger, and thank Dr. Gravis and the choir for the magnificent music all month long and always, always. So, today, directly following this service, and I'm so glad to see so many of you, we are having our annual meeting. We're gonna keep it short and sweet because I know it's Super Bowl Sunday, and I know people have places to go and teams to root for, but it's really important in terms of showing up and using your agency to both elect new vestry members, to pass a budget, to think and plan for the future of our church. And so your presence is so very important in that process, and thank you for being here and showing up. We will have a list, a sign-in list for pledging members to pick up your ballots and your surveys. We have a list of those who have given us that written pledge. If you happen to fall into the category of giving on a regular basis and attending church on a regular basis but did not make a written pledge, there's a second list of names there. So just be patient with us as we make sure that we include all of you who are an active member of this church in that process. Those will be the folks that have voice and vote when it comes down to making decisions, but any of you who would like to be a part of that process are welcome to join us too. We'll just ask you to sit in a non-voting area, but that's kind of following the traditions of our diocesan and our church policies, but you are most welcome. Let me see. There are many announcements because we are entering into Lent. And on Tuesday, we're going to gather in front of the church around 6 o'clock with a live New Orleans jazz band, the Bayou Bump. And we're going to enjoy some live music and have some delicious red beans and rice and some gumbo and cornbread and salad. And then we will burn the palms that I hope you all have brought. Did you bring your palms? You can bring them on Tuesday, but we burn those palms in order to make ashes for Ash Wednesday. And then on Ash Wednesday, we'll have services at 7 a.m., which will be a simple spoken prayer service. And then at 12:10, we'll hear a homily. And at 7 p.m., we'll have both our choir, our magnificent choir, and a homily at that time. So please come, and we invite you to participate in the Holy Lent. That begins on Wednesday. Then during Lent, we have several offerings. One is that we're going to have a Bible study that's going to begin, and that will be online Zoom beginning February 20th from 7 to 8 p.m. All of these announcements should be in your bulletin. In addition to that, we're going to be offering a baptismal class for those who either have a child who would like to be baptized, or if you yourself have not been baptized and would like to do so. We will have our next baptism will be at Easter, at the Easter Vigil. So it will be a chance to go through that process. Likewise, we're going to have an inquiries class that if you're new to the Episcopal Church and you want to learn more about the Episcopal Church or you have questions to ask, we're going to have an inquiries class, and that will also lead to confirmation if for those of you who have not been confirmed or received into the Episcopal Church, and that will take place in May. So there are lots of ways to get involved in the life of St. John's Cathedral and in our church. And again, that is our call. And then lastly, we have our food pantry next Saturday between 8 and 10 a.m. And that happens. It's been a ministry of this church and cathedral for decades. We distribute anywhere serving at least 100 people and 400 plus family members on a monthly basis. So that's a really important ministry that you make happen. And the Laos Chamber Music, they are in collaboration with Dr. Gravis. They've been working to compose an original new piece of music, a requiem, and that will be performed here on February 24th. At 7 p.m. So stay tuned, mark your calendars now. Oh, one last sad piece of news. The Morris family, Meredith Morris, lost her daughter, Anna, 2 days ago. And so a service will be forthcoming. We will share that information with you. But the Morris family is here with us today. And we ask you to hold them in prayers. We pray for Anna, knowing that she is resting with God at this time. Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and our labors to God.
Song, we pray up in the middle of the empty.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, for the wonderful grace and virtue declared in all your saints, who have been the chosen vessels of your grace and the lights of the world in their generations. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he'd given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Amen. till sunset. Men work hard every day, but come sunny, oh, come sunny, that's the
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, You have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with the spiritual food in the sacrament, his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God, Almighty Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
truth boldly, then go work for justice, freedom, and peace.